This video is not exclusively for use by INFP personality types. That is just the perspective from which I can speak with the most authority. What I promote in this video I hope can be taken into account by any intuitive creative. The muse of this video is the highly authentic and highly unique Norwegian music artist Aurora, an INFP personality. I want to cover how it is she greatly differs from other INFPs and explore what the rest of us might be able to do in order to bring some of that authenticity she has to ourselves. Now, this video is actually piggybacking off of another video done by a channel called The Anxious Idealist. I don't know the creator's name, but that is a very in-depth analysis on, from an MBTI perspective, on Aurora as an INFP. I'll link that below. This video goes a lot more niche, but I'll get to that in a moment.
Hello. Hello, guys. How are you?
I first discovered Aurora back when basically everyone else did, back when her first album released. I enjoyed it, but it was a little too melancholy for me overall. I didn't look much further than individual tracks at the time. Just recently, I saw a video of a live performance from her and was reminded of just how good and unique she was. So I decided to check out what she's been up to and listen to her albums, and I really quite like them. As I watched more and more of her, though, I started thinking to myself, this chick is an INFP. So I went on a bit of an Aurora binge, and the more I watched of her mannerisms and her views and her approach to life in general, it actually became quite spooky, because what I saw was me. Now, anyone who knows me and sees her wouldn't make that connection at all. Because what I saw was me turned inside out. INFPs are supposed to be reserved and if shy. We're supposed to be selfish and avoidant, and some even say dumb. When you read career lists, though, of the INFP, you're seeing things like natural psychologists and artists and art directors. Well, those are not dumb people. And they're certainly not shy. I am willing to bet that if you were to jump back maybe 5,000 years ago and you sought out some INFPs back then, you'd be probably finding a very different beast. It is a common thing to hear people suggest that we need to put politicians onto DMT. It is a simplistic notion, but the reason why they suggest that is psychedelics break the psychological molds that we set for ourselves. They reach in under the rug and they pull out things that we try to stay repressed and hidden within us, and they hold it up in our faces and say, deal with this. Ayahuasca trips are often referred to as 20 years of therapy in one hit. That's what I believe the INFPs are. They refer to INFPs as the mediator. I think they're the DMT hits of society. We have a very high level of empathy, a high intuition, a high ability to see things lying beyond the frame. We have this integral need for authenticity and openness, and all of this is punctuated by this really strong sense of conviction. I strongly believe that over the millennia, this personality type has evolved this way. We served the tribe by finding alternate avenues for where society could and should be going, and we drew them out and we held them up to inspire the more practical personalities to actualize those changes. People today presume that society operates now simply the way that it should, that it is optimized for the human condition. Well, no. Somehow, I'm not quite buying that the path for humanity is to dedicate all of our greatest minds towards putting the internet onto a toaster. We're raised as children to devote the majority of our time towards serving industry and to specialize and to treat the economy as the one true cause. But that's not true, though, is it? We all know that that's not the right path for humanity deep down. I know that, you know that, I know that you know that, and I'm not letting you lie to yourself anymore. That is what I think the INFP has done for the tribe, and it is what I think we have forgotten we are. We are the shamans, we are the druids, the campfire storytellers, the farseers. But in our modern societies, we are now beaten down with priority because we don't fit into this industrialist mold. We daydream too much, we're too sensitive, we're not conducive to the economy, we're not productive or marketable personalities. And we buy into it because we're born into it. But every now and then, one of us rises up through the cracks, delivering her authentic self, breaking the mold on how the world works and revealing to all how else things can be done. And other INFPs start to take notice. We start looking around and seeing the cracks for ourselves, and we start to remember who we are.
Yes, it was, yeah.
And what about this vocal sound? I mean, you came on like the Wicked Witch of the West. I mean, is this is this you?
No, that's Kathy in Wuthering Heights. That was who I was in that particular song. I don't think it's me. I don't think I'm very like her. The voice was really just to create a mood. The whole song is like Kathy is a spirit at that point. And it seemed the sort of way a spirit would sing, you know, very ethereal.
Shakespeare is INFP, Edgar Allan Poe, Albert Einstein, Thomas Jefferson, Charles Darwin, Marie Curie, Socrates, Abraham Lincoln, Edward Snowden. People who saw through the veils and reached in and pulled out the truth for people to deal with. Highly empathetic, highly abstract, psychological explorers and embracers of darkness. Highly sexual, highly creative, unreserved in our exploration, and with no respect at all for anything status quo. Back when I was 15, Kurt Cobain was the public figure I felt the most connection with, but he had just killed himself maybe 2 years before him. What I saw in him was just pure release.
Pick me, yeah. Let alone I'll see no. At least, yeah. You can even swallow. Pick me, yeah. Everyone is waiting. At least,
I didn't know I was one, I didn't know he was one, but I just saw something there, this raw authenticity I hadn't seen represented anywhere else. The only other place where I'd seen it, in fact, was in his wife, Courtney Love, who turns out is an ENFP.
No!
Both of them off stage were very understated individuals. On stage, they became monsters, just pure over the top in terms of release. And I think that's key right there. I think the overstatement of who they released on stage was the result of the repression of their personalities off stage. And because of this, their methods of release were self-destructive, in Kurt's case, catastrophic. I have never personally known other INFPs before, and I didn't know there were other people like me out there. I've always had friends, and good ones, multiple groups of them which I could swap between freely, but I never fully fit into any one of those groups. I thought it was because I was somehow broken, and society, whether indirectly or directly, always led me to believe that. As I grew up and learned more about INFPs, I knew intellectually that there had to be more of us around somewhere. But the problem is we're so damn beaten down and self-contained these days that we can go our entire lives without ever meeting another person like that, despite maybe even meeting hundreds of them along the way, just never knowing that they're there. I think because of that, a lot of us wind up leading very lonely lives. Enter Aurora. I have been on this journey of self-realization for a while now, and despite years of failure and self-doubt, I've always known deep down to the very core that I am on the right path. What I've just found in Aurora is an exclamation mark.
He told me I could walk away, but I wouldn't get far. Oh, tell me, how do people know what is right, what is love? He told me I belong in a churchyard.
Aurora is INFP in stereo. If that chick ain't a druid, I don't know what is. She is truly unique, and the authenticity of her is unprecedented in today's society, regardless of personality. She is highly empathetic, highly attentive, and connected with her environment.
I need to take off my shoes. It's just better. Life is better without shoes.
She might seem a little Disney fairy and childlike, but she's actually quite mature under the surface.
I just have better things to do with my time than to watch myself sing.
Fair enough.
You know? And yeah.
What other things are you doing?
Well, I like to paint, I like to read books and cook and masturbate and all of those stuff.
This sounds like just a regular night for me. Yeah.
She's also very in touch with and embracing of both light and dark concepts.
It's a nice thing to greet your demons as friends, because it makes you so powerful, I think, because you realize how much you learn and how much you grow and how natural part they are, and also how much they make you appreciate the light. And it's just such a nice image, I think, having your demons like greet you as a friend and as a warrior and as a victor.
Now she's a bit of a fruit loop, let's be honest here.
I am in pain. So I need to take this off. This is the stuff you have on your most precious thing, your wine.
You wouldn't hire her to do your accounts.
I've been running. Because I was too late to my own live stream, so I had to...
Her dress sense is sensational. She looks completely different every time you see her, and her hairstyles and her makeup, her little accessories and stickers and things that she puts on her face, they're just fantastic, I think. That is a very INFP thing. Now, I'm not an example of this, but I have... deep down, always had a real interest in fashion on other people and in the industry and all that type of thing, and I put it very heavily into my work. everything Aurora does, she goes all in. Not just when she's on stage, but in every area of life, in every aspect, she goes all in and she fully embraces whatever it is she's doing at the time. Where Kurt and Courtney restrained themselves, I think, too much to one side and then went too far to the other, Aurora is far more balanced across all aspects in life.
And my dreams become sweeter when something is missing. I'm in love where the heart is at. It makes me feel alive, alive. If I never get lost in my head, let it go.
From the tribal era, an INFP without the fear.
And so am I, and here I go.
Aurora is how I have always felt inside, right from when I was a child. But I have always been just too scared to express that. And when I look at the comments on numerous videos of her interviews and so forth, I can see there are a hell of a lot of people out there who feel the same. So I started to wonder, what is the difference between her and I? Where have I gone so wrong while she has gone so clearly right? As I looked more and more into things, I started to come up with a few theories here and there, and I started thinking about how I might do a video analysis on Aurora as an INFP. But then I found someone else had already done it, the Anxious Idealist. And he has a far better grasp on MBTI than I'll ever have myself. In finding his video, though, that has freed me up to focus upon a more practical niche, and that is identifying the bridge between her and other common INFPs. What I'm going to try and do is identify and analyze the building blocks behind her inhibition. I am then going to illustrate how I myself apply similar principles to try to overcome my own blockages. Now, she is way ahead of me, but what I might be able to do is provide a first step for others who might be a little more lost in order to try and actualize their own journey. Maybe we can all get just that little bit closer to her level of authenticity, which I truly do believe is the INFP's natural state. As an aside, I am obviously observing Aurora from afar here. I do not know her personally, and I am guessing on all of this, so you'll have to keep that in mind.
I got a very big shock when I kind of turned into when I grew older, because I was very sensitive as a child, but I was very protected by my parents from anything that was really, really sad that happened out there, because I was really inequipped emotionally to deal with the inevitable sadness out there, because it was just too much. And I think that's why I started making music in the first place.
Okay, so music became a coping mechanism.
I think so, because I was a very sensitive child, which I think many children are, and many people can recognize themselves with, so it's not really anything special. But I think it started out as a very good coping mechanism and a way to raise questions and make my own answers.
INFPs and many other introverted personality types are highly sensitive and feel things very strongly. Because we give intimately, we also receive very intimately as well. Now, as adults, that can be nothing but a benefit to both us and those around us. But as children, it can leave us very vulnerable to the oppression of society and the opinions of perhaps people with a straighter edge. I spent my childhood locked in this state of perpetual fear and this certainty that I was broken, that I did not belong in this world. I have spent the majority of my adulthood trying to sort through this. Now, I had a couple of external factors which aggravated things, but ultimately it was me giving in to the fear that did the most damage long term. I only have myself to blame for upholding that false narrative within myself, and I have to get myself out of it.
Son of a bitch, am I driving? Am I driving? Where the there's nobody.
INFPs find it very easy to detach from this world and drift off into their own exploration of abstract concepts. This method of escape is one of our greatest assets, but it can also be a very easy way for us to avoid confronting life's obstacles. It is this fear that brings us the self-doubt. It makes us question our own intuition and keeps us self-contained. We must learn to counter that fear. The most defining moment for myself in countering my fear was the realization that the rest of the world are just as clueless about things as I am. In learning more about anthropology and the agricultural revolution, the industrial revolution, and capitalism and communism and society in general, it has become very clear to me that our modern society is too removed from the Homo sapiens' ideal living condition. And I mean for everyone, even those personality types who fit quite well into this society now that we have, even they are subject to falling to their own confirmation bias without the appropriate counterbalance to challenge their views. If you look back 100,000 years or so that we have been in this Homo sapien form, there aren't too many 60-hour work weeks to be found there. There aren't too many overly complex vertical structural hierarchies, at least nothing just ascending the level of the basic tribe. All of the more complex stuff doesn't happen until perhaps the last 5% of our timeline, maybe 10, but mostly about 5%. The moment we developed agriculture was the moment the concept of wealth entered our minds, and that's when things started to lean off balance. Throughout history, every personality type has played an integral role in the group. Just how women and men have counterbalanced and complemented each other throughout history, the 16 personality types have done the same. But now with industrialization, we've lent too far towards that focus upon wealth, and each subsequent generation has been raised to believe that this is the optimal human way. But only a few personality types actually fit into a factory or cubicle role, and even then I doubt it serves them very well. The others are meanwhile ham-fisted into compliance, and are taught to question their natural states because they don't fit into these industrialized standards. But we don't fit in. That's the point. That's the strength. That's our means of contribution for the tribe, and we don't want to lose that. We are the direct antithesis of the modern day status quo. But when that status quo is broken, then those who do not fit in actually become quite valuable to the rest. Our only option is to embrace our authenticity and to have faith in our intuition. Society needs us maybe more than ever now to illustrate how else things can be done. But we can only do that through building confidence in our voice. So how do we get past that self-doubt?
Where I was very lucky, and I'm very lucky with my parents. They're just brilliant people, and they never said anything about anything. They just allowed me to be free. And if the teacher said that Aurora is a bit different or a bit strange and we might need to blah blah blah, they were like, no, she's just herself. And they were very very clear about that nothing is wrong, even though you're a bit different than the few people you see around you right now. Because out there, the world is so big. And I think I knew that from a very young age, that the world is much bigger than my little town.
Yeah. How many lived in your little town?
Not many, I think like 300 people.
Wow.
And the school only had like 9 students.
Wow. Aurora grew up in highly optimal circumstances for an INFP. It feels as though she lived in a very open-minded and progressive household. She talks about moving at a very early age out to a rural community surrounded by nature, and her school was tiny. She still mentions not fitting in and not enjoying school, but it doesn't seem to me as if she has been hounded in any way. She has been allowed to be herself. Her parents seem to have backed her up the entire way, and coupled with the limited amount of oppression she received from the outside, that, I think, allowed her authentic foundations to take hold.
I think I am, or I strongly believe that, of course, our childhoods has a lot to say with the person we eventually become. But I also think we have way more power than we believe, that we don't have to necessarily blame the things in our childhood.
No, we're not defined by a childhood.
Yeah, we're not defined by it, because we have so much potential and so much power to become whatever we want. And I think that is the biggest gift I've been given, that I've been told that so many times, that I have the power to change what I want to change and to be what I want to be.
It sounds a lot closer to the old ways, the tribal ways. She talks adamantly about walking in nature and being in touch with nature, and I think her childhood really did cater to that INFP need. And this embrace that she has for the nature and the surrounding world carries on over to the way she interacts with people as well. You see it in the interviews that she has. She hones right in on the interviewer and really engages them, really allows them to feel heard and acknowledged. Although she's still quite young, her level of empathy and her expression and that connection she is able to make with people clearly hasn't been challenged at all in her childhood, at least not enough to foster any level of self-doubt. She doesn't seem to have been forced to any form of industrialized curriculum, and her confidence has suffered no hits. It's as if that unbridled sense of curiosity and adventure that we all were as children never met any roadblocks along the way. Aurora would not have gone very well at the schools that I went to. I just don't think she would have been encouraged at all, and in fact, maybe quite the opposite. I think she would have been left thoroughly believing herself to be the problem. I completely failed at school. I was a total underachiever, and I went through childhood and adolescence utterly convinced of that very thing. But as I have gotten older, and I have learned more about myself and also the education system and society in general, I know now with absolute clarity that the problem was not me.
I think I've just found the whole system of school something that didn't really appeal to me. I couldn't really express myself in that whole system.
So presumably your favourite lesson was music?
I did enjoy music and English, but I just didn't really enjoy school as I got older.
I learned more in the 2 years following school than I did in the previous 12 years combined. And I am willing to bet that that is the same for a lot of other people out there. it makes me wonder how many Auroras are being actively crushed by this.
I was lucky to have good teachers mm-hmm. that understood. So when I asked them if I could, I often asked my teachers if I could go, when I felt really restless, mm-hmm. I asked if I could go out and run mm-hmm. one time around the school and then come back in.
So you had and they full of allowed energy me. As a child. Did you think that the school, like the system, as we talked about, that it held you down a little bit, that everything had to be in boxes? Was that something you thought like that was not good for your energy?
Well, I think it's good sometimes to learn or to be utfordret.
Challenged.
Yeah. To be challenged in a way that kind of makes you break your own pattern. I think mm-hmm. that's a very healthy thing for all people and children to experience. But of course, I think the schools aren't made for people who are very energetic or mm-hmm. That struggle with paying attention.
My nieces both go to a Montessori school now, and I have gained an insight into how they operate. And I admit, it kind of hurts to see what is available. I really do think, had I gone to a place like that I would have absolutely flourished there, and who knows the type of person that I would be now. But there is no use in mourning what could have been. What I might best do instead is draw from my experience and audit and analyze it and draw out the key moments and influences, and I can then collate it all together into a central narrative of concepts for what else might be done. The moment we choose to actively work towards making the world a better place is the moment the troubles and the catastrophes of our lives become worth it. They become assets to us. Assets that we can employ in the execution of this endeavor. I can use my history and my experience to maybe help better this world just that little bit. And so can you. Once you master a skill, you master yourself, and that mastery unlocks the paths to all other skills in turn. I think Aurora's unrestrained childhood allowed her to habitualize that freedom of expression into her psyche, and that has established a level of confidence that she now has to attack everything else in turn. She just does it in every manner of life. She's basically a drunk person, just with the mental clarity and the motor function still maintained. Everything she does, she just goes all in. She has no limits, no restrictions. Her music is unrestricted and highly unique. Her delivery of that music, like her singing, is phenomenal. And she's a very good natural dancer as well. She just sort of feels it and flows through it.
Where I had to make all the clothing from old stuff, so everything is remade. I didn't buy anything new for the video. Everything is just made at home and recycled from old dresses. This pearl necklace I made myself, and the headpiece, as I just got to, I hope it's still intact. So this is the headpiece that I was wearing, and I actually I found clothing in my closet, and I took off every single pearl that any outfit had, if that makes sense. So every piece of clothing that had a pearl or a bead stitched on it, I took off. It took like 3 days, and I mixed all the different pearls together to make this a headpiece.
She does everything herself with complete confidence, and her mannerisms and her theories on the world, they're all uniquely hers. Now, the young, there are 20-year-olds' theories, but they're unbridled and free-flowing, while most others her age, well, most others of every age, are barely able to voice their opinions at all. She is thoroughly adamant in maintaining full control over her work. Apparently her producer doesn't get much say in things at all, and I totally get that. I'm the same way with my own. It has to be her voice, otherwise what's the point? I mean, you're just making a product then, and what do you get from a product? Money? There's no value in that. She is utterly authentic in everything she does.
Very liberating. It's like dreaming and sleeping, but being very awake and eating the best meal and having sex and swimming and flying at the same time.
Yeah.
It's all of it. And also crying. It can also be very painful to write music. It depends, of course, what you're inspired by in the moment. But it's very nice. I'm very happy that... I'm very grateful that I'm allowed to make music and that I have it in me, because it's the only thing I understand.
I really do think that her mastery of her authenticity from childhood is what now fuels her embrace and in turn mastery of everything else. When you are confident, when your morale is high, you greatly gain in your ability to absorb and to learn and to develop.
Throughout my life, I will always change and try different things. And throughout my career as an artist, I never want to just keep myself to one genre or to make albums that sound the same. I have a really strong urge to make something new every time.
My head was all over the place as a kid, and the one place where I did focus on was my perceived flaws. I was mastering self-doubt and fear, and that in turn sabotaged my capabilities to master anything else. I always had these stories in my head, these scenes and conversations and things were occupying me 24/7, but I never had any thing I could do with them. I never had any way of delivering them to the world. But then I went all in on my writing. And through mastering that craft, I developed my ability to express my authentic voice. I am now developing my ability to deliver that voice through other channels in turn. I know now that to learn something is simply a matter of concentration and time. And through each new skill I gain yet another means of projecting that voice. I gained an interest in graphic design, and now I do all my own covers and branding. I do my own website work now. I mean, I use Wix, so I'm not coding anything, but I do the layouts and the updates and everything without having to pay anyone to do that. And video work. Everything you see with this video, for better and worse, is all my own work. The more I learn, the more I want to explore. I want to delve into every concept. I want to write across every genre. I want to make film. I want to make games again. I want to create products and build social systems and all manner of things. To counter your self-doubt, you need to strengthen your voice. So pick something and go all in.
Okay. Oh, now we are taking it down a notch. I'm itching a bit on my bum, but I don't want to do it on the camera. Can you just film Magnus while I scratch my butt? No?
I even put small stickers on my piano to remember what chords to touch with my left hand, but they only confused me more. That's why I fucked it up. Sorry if someone is young watching it. And I fucked up the second verse a bit, or at some point I did, as you may have heard. But I tried to just play cool and pretend that I didn't.
When you find a rock in the middle of the road blocking your path, you don't make any emotional reaction to it. You just simply walk around. Yet, when we attempt to express ourselves creatively and we stumble, all too often we take personal, intimate offense and we refuse to progress any further. But all we're doing is simply walking the path of developing a skill. We have simply come to a rock in the road, and all we need to do is walk around. Each time they close their eyes, say goodbye and rest. No, rest. Seems to have internalized this premise by default. She has no self-consciousness with making mistakes at all.
Next verse. Damn it. I thought I was going to do one flawless one. It never happens. There is a flaw to my name. Pure, and we have to get you out of here.
She simply just laughs at it, accepts it, and moves on. She knows she's human, she knows everyone makes mistakes, it does not faze her one bit, and she just continues on and flows back into that moment once more.
Back to me after so let's creature. I know then it's fearsome hearts. I wouldn't mind. I got memories that travels my mind. Fear not when you go. I got pieces of your hate in my soul. Look at me now, I'm falling apart in daylight. All the pieces that I've lost, I have lost.
When someone criticizes you, there are two outcomes. Either they're right or they are wrong. If they are right, good. You've just uncovered a flaw that you have missed, and you can now do something about it. If they are wrong, then you've just solidified your position all the more. I have dyslexia, and it has been a huge influence on my life for worse and better. 10 years ago, when I really started honing in on writing, I sent one of my books to be professionally assessed, and she really liked the story, found it highly unique and all that, so awesome. But one thing she pointed out was that there were parts in it which were completely indecipherable. Now this surprised me completely, because I thought it was perfect, of course, because all naive authors do. So what I did was I started reading it with that in mind, purposefully looking for that issue. And yeah, she was completely right. It was utterly indecipherable in places. And this blew my mind, because I had, up until that point, no idea as how... I never gave any consideration as to how the rest of the world received my communication. So I started looking for where else I might be dropping the ball here, and I started finding it everywhere. What this did was switch on my ability for self-analysis. And from that point on, anything I wrote, whether definitely a book, but anything, any email, any text message, any Facebook post I wrote, I would go over again and again and again, and I would restructure and I would re-edit, and I would think about the receiver's position and perspective, and I would take that into account, and I would re-edit and re-edit again and go over it multitude of times until it was perfect, and only then would I send it out. I would be actively asking every single time, no matter what I did, where am I wrong? Because it's gotta be here somewhere. And so I would search and search until I proved myself wrong. And over the following years, I essentially, well, for all intents and purposes, I essentially trained myself out of dyslexia. It's still there. It still shows up from time to time, like when I'm trying to make a YouTube video, for example. But it doesn't fluster me anymore. It used to really shut me down in school and so forth. But now I know I only need to just pull back, reassess, edit, and redeliver. And that's all you need to do as well. Expect flaws, search for them, embrace them, because with everyone you find, you advance just that little bit more. You come to a rock on the road, and that's all it is. It's just a diversion. Even if that rock is huge and public and it's laughing at you, it's still just a diversion. Just stop, take stock of the situation, reassess, and go around.
Oh, yes, I forgot. Sorry, I really tried to do it perfect for you, but it's impossible. Possible. But yes, I forgot that I accidentally wrote the second chorus in that song differently. It wasn't planned. I didn't notice before, after the song was recorded, that I had written an entirely new chorus for the middle part. And then it's the same chorus in the first and the third chorus is the same. And which is kind of strange. I don't know why I did it. It just happened and it just fits the song. But it's easy to forget when you do it live because it doesn't happen a lot, you know? My lips are really chapped. And it's really annoying. I think it's because I've been outside a lot in the cold today. And when it's cold, I'm going to check the time. Oh, and when it's cold, your lips get chapped. I think I said this last time as well, and then I put honey on it. Or olive oil. But you need to make sure the honey is from a place where they treat the bees very nicely. Because many, many bees are treated very bad. Which is horrible. Because they're so sweet and so small. And for being so small, they're still such an important part of the world and the ecosystem of the world. It's quite incredible, isn't it? If the bee can, then you can. Hear me, war young Padawan. If the bee can, you can. But if I can, then you can. But yes.
Have a favorite moment from the start to finish of the creating and the thinking and recording and producing of this album?
Sorry,
Most of my best memories are fake, and that is not a bad thing. They are stories and events and conversations that I have in my mind, usually in response to some event or question in the real world, or engagements that I've had, or stories that I am creating. What I do is just simply detach my mind and let myself drift off down whichever tangent of contemplation my mind wishes to explore at the time. Throughout my life, I have considered this to be a negative, and those daydreams I treat it as a hindrance to me because they got in the way of becoming some productive member of society. I felt I was just wasting time and losing these huge chunks of life that I couldn't draw anything from. Now, the story-related content obviously soon became actually quite valuable because I could just deliver all of that into my work, but I was still using a lot of time on other random tangents which I just couldn't see any use for. But one day I realized they are the very source of everything that is me.
I don't know why I want to make music all the time, and I don't really understand why I need to make music, but I feel so much better after I've made something, and I feel such at peace with existing, I think, when mm-hmm. I write and play, because I don't have to question why I'm here anymore. No. Because it just makes sense, because music is so beautiful, and I feel like music is such an important thing. Especially now, it becomes more and more important, I think, with time, because the world and society is getting more and more cynical. Mm-hmm. And I feel like we're losing the language of the soul. Like, there's nothing, almost nothing left mm-hmm. here in this world that speaks directly to the heart and the soul. Because mm-hmm. we have so much that speaks to the mind and the brain and, you know, taking space, noise everywhere. And I think that's why I love music, because it just speaks directly to the soul.
Our daydreams are how we are able to deconstruct the world and to uncover what else can be done. They are a critical source of defining our personal values, and the conversations we have in our mind are the refinement methods for those concepts. The problem is that all too often we do not retain those findings, and in fact we actively reject them as some form of liability. But I think we need to embrace those times. We need to steer them from within to uncover and solidify those abstract concepts so that we can then draw them out and re-deliver them through our chosen means.
I really envy the people that can just fall asleep in like 10 minutes. I always spend 2 hours falling asleep, but that's life. It's because I think so much and I always come up with the greatest ideas when I'm about to sleep, you know? I come up with all the greatest lyrics and melody lines, and I just can't sleep.
When you look at Aurora's lyrics, you can see that she actualizes those daydreams. She has a high level of abstract in her lyrics, with a strong connection to her own values and authenticity. But she also has very pointed music as well. Some songs which focus upon, say, a murder scene or an abuser or something like that. But what she does is she tells them from their perspective. As beautiful in nature she seems to be, in her daydreams, I'd think she has allowed herself to become evil. She is in the mind of the killer or the obsessive. She makes a significant effort, I think, to see it from their perspective. It's not to justify what they're doing, but to understand it. She explores darkness and blends it with the light.
Thank you for the nice energy. And from now on, this show will be a bit less sad, won't it? Because we have almost done all the sad songs. Even though all my songs are kind of sad. But many of them are kind of hidden in a nice bag of something that's not so sad. So the next song is kind of sad, but it's not so sad. Okay. It's called I Went Too Far, and it's about not forgetting that you deserve to be loved as much as you love someone else. I went too far when I was begging on my knees, begging for your arms, for you to hold around me.
In my own work, I really like to explore the beasts that we are deep down, and how we act when we're placed in the most extreme of circumstances, for better and worse. How is it that war can be fun? How can explicit combat be ecstatic? Like, what is the beauty to be found there? Where is the peace and the tranquility in chaos? Within the depths of darkness, we find the most heavenly light. These are all concepts I explore in my own work because I just don't see them anywhere else, and I want to know for myself. I'm really looking forward to Aurora's work in about 10 years' time, because as good as it is now, she's still just in her 20s, like she's only just arriving towards the functions of people and society. When she hits her 30s though, that's when she's going to start diving really deep, I think, and exploring things that society may not want to learn. Our daydreams are where we can play the best devil's advocate. We can counter our own views and represent the opposing side by throwing this character against that character and see what comes out in the end. That is how we refine our core values. Now, obviously, it's always better to have actual people to converse with. You're always subject to your own confirmation bias. But we can do the next best thing. And we can do it anytime we like. What I do is first thing in the morning, I make myself a coffee and then I just simply sit and face nature. I just sit and I stare and I tap into these worlds and I meet these characters and I hear what they have to say and how they contend with my views. The findings of these sessions become the foundations of my work. They become the core of my values, my perspective on all things. We need to own our daydreams and not just let them drift away. We must capture them and analyze them. We need to make them real and make them work to our favor.
Being an artist have helped me love people, because there are so many things with humankind that are just rubbish. Mm. And you think, what the hell is wrong with these people? And why do humans suck? Mm-hmm. That's a very frequently asked question, I think, because we do so many strange things and all the problems we have been created by ourselves, and we make everything so complicated, and it's just very demotivating. But touring has helped me see that people are quite beautiful, and that there are people like me out there, people that maybe just feel a bit on the outside sometimes, or introverts, and the people that no one is listening to that often have the most to say, which is really annoying, because they could be the best leaders, I think, but they never get the chance to be heard. So it's a really heartbreaking thing. But yes, it helped me love people. When you see people cry, how can you not love them when you look at them showing? And finally, people in the audience are actually showing what they're feeling, not hiding like all the people. So it just gives me...
It gave you more energy in there.
Yes.
Now, this is where Aurora herself, I think, might disagree with me, because spontaneity is such an important thing to her.
We knew that we had to just keep the vocals as they are, with the tiny flaws they have, because the whole point is not to, you know, sing perfect, and it's never been my point. It's about singing with purpose and singing with emotion, which should be the point in everything you all do also. We can't do anything perfect. We can just do it with kindness and with the right emotion, and that's good enough.
But I suspect that she's actually a little bit more precise in her methods than she believes herself to be. Aurora's track Runaway is her oldest and most predominant work. It's the one that basically launched her. She wrote it back when she was about 11 or 12, I think. And because of that, it is her most refined work. You can tell just by listening to it just how complex it is and how explorative she has been through its refinement. It is a path that she has traveled thousands of times in her mind, and taking little detours and making ever more little refinements along the way. I want you to watch this clip of her performance of this track, and I want you to analyze every aspect you can of her voice. I want you to ignore her physical motions though, only concentrate on her voice. Listen to the variety and the fluctuations of the notes, the way she holds a note, the level of strength she delivers, and when she chooses to release.
To the ocean, I saw a face in the sand, but when I picked it up, then it vanished away from my hands. And I had a dream I was 7, climbing my way in a tree. I saw a piece of heaven waiting in patience for me. And, and I was running far away. Would I run off the world someday? Nobody knows, nobody knows. I was dancing in the rain. I felt in love and I can't complain. But no, take me home, take me home, or I I can take it anymore. The place to go, no, take me home, take me home where I belong. I can take it anymore. But I kept running for a soft place to fall, and I kept running for a soft place to fall, and I kept running for a soft place to fall, and I kept running for a soft place to fall.
It is a big misconception, I think, that creatives must give themselves completely over to the muse. A lot of people I've heard say that they thoroughly believe that that's the only way they can actually deliver, and I do think Aurora feels the same way. But what I notice about her live performances are just how precise they are. They might feel all flowing and organic, but I think she knows well ahead of time exactly where each and every note needs to land. Now in her live streams, I don't think she's managed to get a full song out yet, but that is where she's going full muse. But in her properly rehearsed performances, it's a completely different story. The reason I asked you to ignore her physical motions is because I think that is where the muse is coming through. Her head stays locked on, mouth at the exact distance she needs it to be in order to maintain control. But her hands and limbs are just going everywhere, and I think that is where she is releasing.
Oh,
like a road that she has paved in her mind just through sheer obsessive perfectionism. And she has played it over and over and over, both mentally and physically, and just locked in every single step. But then her need for indulging the muse is still there. And I picture it's like she's simply bringing her body along for the ride, and it's in the back seat and it's jumping around the back seat looking at all the passing scenery while she remains focused completely on the road. You even see her physically snap herself clean of focus states. It's like she's been fully engaged in the previous moment and then has to physically snap herself clean of that instance in order to blank the slate and then re-deliver herself through that next moment.
And you can't remember that day, but you know it happened quiet, so quiet.
She is incredibly controlled in her execution, and I think that comes through her pure ownership of her work. She has so much invested in it. It's all hers. It's not her producers, not her record labels. It is hers, and she makes damn sure it is legit. She lays the footprint down, memorizes it, and her obsession and her perfectionism then hones the finer details over and over again, allowing her to then deliver what she has memorized through complete confidence. This being said, I have noticed in her more recent live performances, now that she has more experience, she tends to be blending the two a lot more. Like she has taken the mic off the stand and she now flows around a lot more freely. That precision, however, is still there. And I notice in some live performances, not all of them, but some of them, the first chorus of a song, she tends to be still really on point and every note is just pitch perfect, but she's much more reserved physically. When you get to the second chorus, however, that's when she's flowing around a lot more because that's the muse is now coming through.
Lies within emotion, always reeling on spanking.
what she herself may think, there is method there. And over the years, I have developed a similar, more purposeful strategy for myself in my own work. It may be because I had to fight through my own insecurities and basically prove it to myself, whereas Aurora obviously hasn't needed to do that. She's just internalized this process through habit, I think. These days, I treat emotional expression just as highly as I do method and structure. And this is certainly not a typical INFP thing, but it's something that I find is working very well for me. What I do, and this is when I'm creating anything, books, this video, visual design, whatever it needs to be, what I do is I break it into three stages. The first is what I call the expression pass. This is coming directly from the daydream state out into the physical world. What I do is I just let the muse fly. I use that expression to lay out the project scope, and I just throw down any and every possible thing I can in whatever shape it wants to come out in, wherever it wishes to land, and I give absolutely zero consideration towards marketability or people's sensibilities or even the ultimate intent for the project. But then, once that muse is addressed, I then set forth and restructure that expression creatively from the meta level. And I refine that work with precision and articulation and control. And then I do it again, and then again, and again, and as many damn times as it needs. I just rework that work constantly, just honing it ever to a more refined edge. Once I have that structure down, it is then once more I can release the muse. In the book sense, I might do an aesthetic pass, make sure the world is beautiful and descriptive, or I do a literary pass to make the actual prose descriptive and elegant. I might do a fashion pass if the book calls for it. I might do a combat pass. Whichever vein the muse wishes to follow, that's what I employ, and I go all in safely now upon that set framework. Allowing fear and doubt robs you of that perfectionism and care that a creative needs to finally hone their work. An artist may not want to be methodical or structured because it might feel inauthentic to them, but when they try to deliver their unrefined work fully through the muse in full expressive release, quite often it doesn't turn out the way that they had hoped, and they start to believe they're just simply not good enough, and that doubt begins to seed. By all means, let yourself go. Let yourself go completely. Scare yourself if you need to, but then capture and refine. Hone that strategically on the meta level. And then once you have that perfect structure in place, you have that assurance and you can get that self-doubt out of the way. Once you have that, turn the emotion back on and deliver through that safe framework with everything that you have. Show the world who you are, your authenticity, your voice, revealing to all what else can be done.
But yes, you give me a lot. And most importantly, you showed me that there are people like me out there, because I didn't feel connected to a lot of the people in my tiny town.
I really think it is an injustice to everyone how society forces abstract thinkers to follow a select line of values. They are taught to fear themselves in order to propel what is ultimately a worthless objective for all. Humanity has been locked to the wrong dial for a long time. But when you pan back and look across our history, it's actually just a blink by comparison. We are in a bubble, a spike, and one that in time I truly think will actually rewrite itself. But that spike, though, lasts hundreds of years, and when we're in it, it is truly hard to see the status quo as anything but the natural way. And we persecute and fear the exploration of alternatives. But every now and then, there is a glitch in the matrix. We catch a glimpse of color, which then draws our attentions to an alternate view. We then start to look around on our own. We start to question things. We start to uncover the cracks for ourselves. And we start to remember who we are.
We will not walk in fear, one of another. We will not be driven by fear into an age of unreason if we dig deep in our history and our doctrine. And remember that we are not descended from fearful men.
I have been on this trail for many years now, gaining more and more confidence as I go that I am indeed on the right path. The discovery, the proof of Aurora has accelerated this. I really hope that this video may perhaps serve as a similar exclamation mark for others. And I hope they too might begin to cast off these compromised opinions of this compromised society to instead hone their own voice. We are not broken. We evolved this way, refined over millennia, because it works. Modern society is truly not serving humanity, and it needs to reevaluate its approach. When all of our elements are flowing to full effect, supporting and complementing the strengths of each other, that is when humanity will truly rise.
Very proud of being human.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's my favorite personal trait, that I'm just human like everyone else. That's also my favorite trait about everyone else, that mm-hmm. they're human. And I find everything I feel very fascinating, and I like to really dive into why I'm feeling scared and why I'm feeling happy and why mm-hmm. I'm feeling sad. And I love writing about it and talking to myself about it.
Mm-hmm.
It's very good for the mind to talk to yourself sometimes. You're not crazy, you're perfectly fine. But yes, I've had many, many ups and downs, like most people, I mm-hmm. think, in life. But of course, I've been through quite some extreme things, because being an artist is a very extreme thing. And again, it's not really meant. I don't think humans are meant to experience so much attention or pressure or so much love. Even though it's beautiful, it's also just overwhelming. And also you get a lot of responsibility. People expect you to be more than human, which obviously no one can be.
Mm-hmm. You felt a lot of pressure.
Not really. I don't mm-hmm. feel it here,
yeah.
but I feel it from there.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't really answer to it,
no.
because what's the point with that, you know? Because mm-hmm. you can only be what you can be. And I've always been very kind to myself. That's the biggest thing I try to say to the people that like my music also, that it's so important to be more kind to yourself. We are so mean to ourselves. And it's just heartbreaking to see these perfectly beautiful, perfectly fine people being so strict with themselves and being so judging. Mm-hmm. I've always thought that when I'm down or when I have bad periods of my life, I always think that as long as I manage to end up in my bed alive, I am a successful human being. Because mm-hmm. sometimes your task for the day is only to make it to the next day. Mm-hmm. And then that's perfectly fine. And then you do the same the next day again, until suddenly one day you feel a bit better. But give yourself time. That's mm-hmm. the most important thing. And just be more kind. Don't expect too much of yourself mm-hmm. when you know that what you actually need is just time to heal. Mm-hmm. It's very important.
I am not anticipating making money from this channel. And even if I do, I don't want that money to influence the direction or my schedule in creating content. I'm also not a fan of the Patreon approach. I'd rather just keep what I create free and available to be viewed by anyone. What I have to offer are my books. They are the primary focus point for my creativity and outlet for my views on the world. So if you like my content and would like to support me, that might be the way to do it. If you'd like something quick, visceral, and high concept, then you can try my cyberpunk space opera series, Valesia, a concept for humanity in 1,000 years' time. If you wish to delve a little deeper, then I introduce my master series, Sire, a story of the world over the next 40 years. It begins with my standalone geopolitical action adventure, Tacticolo, three people telling three perspectives on the same near future Black Swan event. Next comes my 12-book epic series, Jive 3-5, the story of our children's great war. Here is where I dive deep into the psychology of who we are and the fabric of our commercial society by following the experiences of a young civilian woman drafted into a war. The rest of the Sayara stories, Gold Digger, Mission, and Dreamland, should become available over the next few years. I also have several period fiction works on the way, set within the First Crusade and 1600s Asia, but also available, for free, are the first two books of my original Star Wars trilogy, The Order of One. This is not a fan fiction, it is an experimental work where I explore the Star Wars license on an adult, philosophical level. Psychological, violence, sexuality, true light, and true dark, definitely not for kids. I write humor, fragility, love and hatred, I cross genre, I defy convention, follow abstract paths and meld light with dark. So if you'd like to see an INFP creative going all in, you can find my work via my website, unalteredaspect.com. Sign up to my mailing list to keep up to date with my book and video releases, and in doing so, you will receive a free copy of my Sayared Dreamland short story, Diva. Otherwise, if you enjoyed this video, I plan to do more essays like this in the future. So please like and subscribe, hit me up in the comments or send me a message via my site or social handles, and let's find out together what else can be done.